And today's event in particular is a special one for us, because it's a sequel from our series. We started talking about computer vision in our previous event, when we're talking about digital out of home cameras and how they do classifications, demographic classifications on people out in retail spaces. And a lot of questions were raised. And so in this second part of the series, we have Romain Bourgoin. I hope I got it right. I tried in front of a mirror before this meeting. Romain, are you ready to tell us, give us your introduction to computer vision and artificial neural networks?
Yes, I am, and you pronounced my name perfectly, so thank you. Okay, am I able to share my screen?
Should be now, thank you.
Okay, can you all see my screen correctly? Yes?
Yes.
Yeah. Yes, sorry.
Sorry, I don't see your camera, so yeah. Okay. Well, first of all, thank you for having me here. I'm Romain Bourgoin. I'm a senior backend engineer at MPB. And as you know, I will present you an introduction to computer vision and artificial neural networks today. So before starting, let's start thinking about the importance of vision in our everyday lives. That's probably the sense that is the most important for us human being. We are really relying on it for a lot of our activities, whether they are professional or personal. And this is something that is quite difficult to implement in programmation. That's a field, so computer vision is a field that is in constant evolution still at the moment. And the day we will solve the problematics of computer vision, it will have a huge impact on the future of automated labor. We know that computers have already automated lots of tasks, but as soon as something relies too much on vision and understanding what's present on an image or in a camera, programs are not that good at dealing with that kind of information. We will also see that computer vision is really closely related to artificial neural network. The reason is quite simple. People have tried for years to do computer vision using traditional programming methods. That was kind of a dead end that was really complicated to work with. And it's now more than a decade or two that everyone agrees on the fact that artificial neural networks are getting much better results than traditional programming methods. So we will talk about artificial neural network mostly in the context of computer vision, but you know that artificial neural networks are much more than that. They're used in a lot of fields. And we already talk about artificial intelligence. That's probably a term that we shouldn't use, because we still don't have any real artificial intelligence yet, but maybe someday with the artificial neural networks, we will get there. So the presentation will be divided on two parts, the first one about computer vision and the second one about artificial neural network. So first of all, let's start with a definition. What is computer vision? So according to Wikipedia, computer vision is an interdisciplinary scientific field that deals with how computers can gain high-level understanding from digital images or videos. So to say it shortly, computer vision is a field that tries to make sense, to get information out of images and videos. There are quite lots of different disciplines in computer vision. Apparently, you had recently a presentation around image classification. So we can see that in image recognition, we have different activities. First of all, we have image classification. In this case, we will, for example, give to a program a list, a group of pictures with cats or dogs, and we will ask the programs to tell us if, if we have a cat or a dog on the picture. Then we have object detection, that's a little bit more complex, where we will give to our program an image with different elements, and we will ask the program to identify the different elements and their position in the picture. And lastly, we have instant segmentation that is going even one step further. We are detecting the elements, their position, but we are also asking our program there to draw very precise boundaries around each elements. We also have, especially with videos, some fields around motion analysis. So we have optical flow and dense optical flow. Those are fields that we'll be talking about during the presentation. And we have tens of other fields. We won't talk about them today. We have seen reconstruction, image restoration, and lots more. So first, why is computer vision so complicated? When we look at this kind of picture, us human, it's really straightforward. That's really something we do very easily. We can see that there's a woman on the picture. She seems to be laughing. She seems to be in a big city. But when we look at the numerical representation of an image, we are just having a huge matrix of numbers. And that gives us lots of constraints. We are dealing with millions of pixels. We are dealing with millions of colors. Those can generate millions of shapes, and it's giving us millions of possibilities in an image. So we need to come with new ways of programming to deal with those problematics. And with computer vision, most of the time we will need to have a lot of computational power. So let's start with a few basic principles of computer vision. An image should be seen as a surface, not just a set of pixels. A point in an image is defined, of course, by its color and its position, but actually it's mostly defined by the other pixels that surround it. And from this first principle comes another one. It's like that computer vision like noise. For example, we have these two pictures of vans. On the left, we're having lots of details. We're having lots of noise. There's an advert on the back of the van. There's a Tesco logo. And at the opposite, on the right side, we're having an image that is white. The van is white, the background is white. And the image in the right will be more complicated to analyze with computer vision. If I was, for example, to take randomly a pixel in the image on the right, I'd probably find a white pixel surrounded by white pixels. And if I try to look at another random one, I'd probably find again a white pixel with random one with one white pixels around it. So that's not something we like very much. We like to have lots of information, lots of noise in the picture. This will appear with features detection. So what is a feature? A feature is defined as an interesting part of an image. And features are used as a starting point for many computer vision algorithms. So what is an interesting part of an image? Here we're having an example with that picture. So we are having the drawing of a building, and we are having in this image six blocks that have been taken out of this image. First, we're having blocks A and B. Even for us human beings, it will be quite difficult to place these two blocks back at the place they come from on the original picture, because they're quite flat. There's not a lot of noise in these two blocks. Then we're having block C and D. It's getting a little bit better. We're having an edge. We start to have an idea of where the block comes from, but that's not perfect yet. And lastly, we have blocks E and F that are having angles. And with those two blocks, we will have absolutely no problem to find their original place in the picture. Basically, blocks E and F are what is defined as a feature. That's part of an image that's having a lot of information that will help us identify this specific part. In real cases, we won't be working with such big blocks. We'll probably be working with blocks of 2x2 pixels or 3x3 pixels, but the principle is the same. We will always try to find this kind of blocks that are very noisy. So what can we do with our features? First, we can do feature matching. So you can see in our example, we're having two different pictures of Notre Dame in Paris. And what we've done, we've taken the first picture on the left. We've identified points of interest, features. Then we've done the same thing on the image on the right. We've tried to identify the point of interest. And then we ran an algorithm trying to match them to identify what feature corresponds to what feature in the other image. And you can see that we have quite a lot of good results. I don't see if you can see my mouse, but here we're having this green feature that matches perfectly this one. Then we're having, for example, this purple one that correctly matches this one on the other picture. But we can quite soon see something. We are also having quite a lot of false positive, of bad matches. And that's something that we need to accept when working with computer vision. I'm coming from a programming field, and as a programmer, we like to have binary information. We like things to be true or false. When dealing with computer vision, it's not the case. We need to accept that and to deal with the bad data and be able to extract out this bad data. What else can we do? Using the exact same method, we can work on optical flow. So here we will do exactly the same thing that we did with Notre Dame, except that we will be working with a video. I can take a frame in the video, then find the features on this frame, then take the frame that is coming after, find the features on this second frame, and then do the exact same feature matching that we've done for Notre Dame. And by doing that, we start to have information about the motions of pixels in this video. And obviously, we can do it to the next frame and then the next coming frame and again and again and again. And we start to see how pixels are moving in our video. So I have a quick example here. Might not be very fluid through Zoom, but here we can see. So I've been working with a video that have been taken inside a moving car. And what I've done is that by using this feature detection and feature matching, every feature that was moving to the right has been colored in blue or purple, and every feature that moves to the left has been colored in green or yellow. Also, the faster a pixel is moving, the brighter it is. So the interesting thing here is that by using this very basic principle, we're starting to have some very interesting information, because we know we're in a moving car. We know that when we're in a moving car, the objects that are moving the fastest are the objects that are the closest to us. And with this detection of motion, we start to gain some information that might help trying to rebuild a 3D environment out of this two-dimensional video. Then I'd like to tell you about the concept of convolution that's used a lot in computer vision. So first, definition of convolution, it's pretty heavy. Convolution provides a way of multiplying together two arrays of numbers, generally of different sizes, but of the same dimensionality, to to produce a third array of numbers of the same dimensionality. This can be used in image processing to implement operators whose output pixel values are simple linear combinations of certain input pixel values. So that's a very complicated definition for a very simple principle. So let's have a closer look at how it works. So in this example, we can see that we have a two-dimensional matrix of number on the left. This matrix could be an image, a black and white image. Zero would be a black pixel, 255 would be a white pixel. Then in the middle, we are having what we call the kernel. This one is 3x3 pixel, and you can see that we have 0.2 in the middle, and all the other values are 0.1. So what are we doing when we are doing convolution? Basically, we're taking our kernel, we are placing it at the top left part of the image, and then we will multiply the values that we have in our pixels with the values that we have in our kernel. So in this first case, the 65 in the middle will be multiplied by the 0.2, and all the numbers that are surrounding the 65 will be multiplied by 0.1. Once we have that, we sum all the values, it gives us 69, and then we place this number in our output matrix. And with convolution, what we will do is that we will move our kernel all along the image and repeat the operation column by column and line by line. Once we've done all the image, we have a full output matrix. And if we look at the values that we have in our kernel, we can kind of understand what we've done on the image. Basically, what we've done, we've taken the value of each pixel, and we kind of mixed its value with the value of all the pixels that are surrounded. So with this kernel, basically what we've done is that we've blurred the original image. Another example of convolution. Convolution can be used for edges detection. So for edges detection, we will need two kernels, one kernel that will detect vertical edges and one kernel that will detect horizontal edges. So how does it work with vertical edges? So here you can see I have an image on the left. All the left part of the image is black, it's full of zero, and the other half of the image, the right part, is white with 255. If we have a look at our kernel here, we will see that we just ignore all the values in the middle. Then we will sum all the values on the right, and we will subtract to that all the values on the left. So let's do our convolution. So we see here in our first step that we are summing all the zeros on the right and then subtracting all the zeros on the left. That will give us a zero. Same thing here. And as soon as we reach an edge, here we can see that we are summing all the 255 and we are subtracting zero out of it. So it will be giving us 765 in our output matrix. Same here. And as soon as we come back to a flat part of the image, this one is all white, we are summing all the 255, then subtracting all the 255, and it gives us zero again. And when we do that on the whole picture, we can see that where we had an edge in the source image, we're having high values in our destination image. And what we've done there is that we've detected the edges of the image. So that's pretty interesting that such a simple principle that convolution is, just by working on your kernel, you can have some algorithm that will get some information out of an image. And then lastly, regarding computer vision, here is a quick video that's quite close to the one we've seen a bit earlier. So in this video, what we're doing, we are trying to do optical flow, we are trying to detect motion, just like we did in the previous video. But you can see that on the first one, we were just focusing on our features, on the point of interest that we detected. Those points were easy to work with. But in this second example, we are trying to detect the motion of every single pixel of the video. So that's much more complex. And here we're already seeing big limitations. The result is far from being perfect. And this algorithm I wrote myself is taking 1 hour of computation just to do the calculation for one frame. So if I wanted it to run real time, I should optimize my application by 90,000 times, which is clearly impossible. So the problem with computer vision is that if we can do a lot of interesting things with traditional programming method, we soon reach a very big limitation. And that's why we knew a new method to work with computer vision. And that's where artificial neural network are entering. So that's the end of the first part. Second part will be about artificial neural network. Just I would like to allow you, any of you who would have any question about this first part, to ask me those questions.
Thank you. So please, in the audience, you want to dive deeper into any of the issues raised here, from classification, feature detection, feature tracking, convolutional method. Any questions here? Please feel free to either raise your hand or come and unmute yourselves.
Can I ask a question? Can I ask please, a question?
Yes, please, go ahead, John.
What libraries are you using, like OpenCV, neural networks, you know, like,
Sorry, is the question about neural networks or about...
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
What libraries are you using, like OpenCV or like PyTorch, that kind of stuff for neural networks and then like, you know?
Oh, yes. I've been working a lot with OpenCV, and even some images that I used in the presentation are taken from the OpenCV website. That's definitely a great library. To work with computer vision, that's the one I would definitely recommend. And for regarding neural network, I started to work with TensorFlow, and quite soon changed for PyTorch, which I think is much more modular and probably a better choice for someone with a programming background.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks for the question, John. Anybody else want to probe this further?
There's a question on the chat.
Oh, I missed that. Thank you, Bakur. Oh yes, Pranath asks, what are the application you are hoping to apply this to? What's your primary application of computer vision?
Well, I've always focused a lot on the optical flow. That's why you have a few examples of optical flow in my presentation. And it comes with something else that I do. I mean, that's very related to dense optical flow. I'm working on video frame prediction. So basically it's feeding a neural network with 5 frames on a video and asking the neural network to predict the coming one based, once again, on the motion. I've been experimenting a lot of things around videos. I've been implementing a neural network that would put colors on a black and white video. But yeah, I'm definitely not an expert on every disciplines of computer vision. The one that I think most of people are working on, which is element detection and element classification, I'm not spending a lot of time on it. I'm really passionate about this dense optical flow thing.
Nice, thank you. There's another question here on the chat I'd like to Race, and it's regarding your first video with the object tracking. Can you differentiate in it objects that are stationary relative to the ground versus, say, cars coming from the other direction? Or are you just getting everything that everything is in motion?
That's a very good question. They are not differentiated, which is an issue, because when we want to do a scene reconstruction and reconstruct the 3D environment out of the video based on the motion of the pixels, if everything is static, that's perfect. You know that the motion is only implied by the motion of the car you're in. But that's true that we're having pedestrians that are walking, we're having cars that are driving in other direction, and this motion algorithm is just detecting any motion, and it's not able to differentiate the motion that is just implied by us being in a moving car from a motion that is implied by another element being in motion itself. But that's definitely a big problematic if you want to try to understand the environment around you from the video, because yes, as you say, you will have some, like, all data are going in the same direction, and then you will have one moving object in the middle that will go in another direction, and you need to be able to differentiate those, and that's probably a big problematic to deal with.
Right. Yes. I imagine the algorithm you showed could be used as an input into a secondary algorithm to perhaps determine a frame of reference and anything that's moving with respect to that in a larger. So yeah, thank you for that question. That question came from Vladislav, by the way. I forgot to mention that earlier. And we have no more questions in the chat. So yeah, please go on. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. So let's talk about neural networks. As we all know, artificial neural networks are largely inspired by biological neurons. How can we define the biological neuron? First of all, it's having multiple inputs represented by the dendrites here. Then it's having an activation threshold, meaning that if enough of the dendrites are firing, at some point, the neuron will itself fire an electrical signal. The biological neuron is having a single value output, and this value is of type Boolean. We rather have an electric signal or we don't have an electric signal. There's nothing really in between. And biological neurons become powerful when they constitute huge networks. Let's now have a look at an artificial neuron. So just like the biological one, the artificial neuron is having multiple inputs. It's also having an activation function. It's also having a single value output, but this one is different. The output is a float number. Basically, what the artificial neuron is doing, it will get all the values coming as input. It will sum those values, and it will send the sum of those values as an output. And just like biological neurons, artificial neurons start to be interesting when we use them in big networks. I'd like to talk about the MNIST dataset. That's a library that is used a lot in a lot of tutorials when we start working with artificial neural network. So the MNIST dataset is giving us a list of, I think, around 60,000 pictures of handwritten digits. And we want to create a program that will be able to recognize these digits. Once again, for us human beings, it's quite an easy task. We can really easily identify most of those numbers. But when we have to do that with traditional programming method, the task becomes extremely complicated. A good thing, though, is that with the MNIST dataset, we have a lot of available data. Neural networks love having a lot of data. So this task should be perfectly adapted to train a neural network. So what exactly do we want to do with that neural network? The MNIST training set is made out of images of 28 by 28 monochrome pixels. What we want to do is for each image, take all the pixels, create a vector of values of 784 values, and give all these values as an input to our neural network. Then what we want is our artificial neural network to do its magic. We will see quite soon what the magic it's doing is. And as an output, we have 10 neurons, each of them representing one of the numbers, and we want our neural network to light up the neuron that correspond to the number that was written on the image. So let's have a closer look at what the neural network is doing. Sorry, I'm having a small issue clicking on the other tab. Okay, just a second. Maybe I'll stop sharing and I'll start again when I'm ready.
Yeah, I think that worked well.
Okay, that's working much better.
Zoom gets in the way sometimes.
Yeah, it does. Okay, can you all see my screen again?
Yes.
All right, thank you. So here, I've really, really simplified the problem. We've just created a very small neural network. We are having only three input neurons. We're having two hidden layers of four neurons each, and we're having only one, two output neurons. And what we will try to do with this one, we will try to do something extremely simple compared to what we want to do with the MNIST dataset. Here, we will always give the same input values to our neural network, so one, minus three, and two. And what we want is our neural network to be able to give us minus 155 and 247. So how the neural network is working, you can see that each of the neurons of one layer is connected to each of the neurons of the next layers. And this connection is different depending on the neurons. We can see that here we're having a small red line between these two neurons, if you can see my mouse moving. And it's because with each of these connections, there's a weight. So here I'm having a weight of minus 0.1 between those two neurons, then I'm having a weight of 0.36 between these two neurons. And when the neural network is running, basically it will take the value of the neuron on the left, multiply it by the weight. So here we are having minus 0.1. Do the same with the next neuron, minus 3 times 0.28. That gives us minus 0.85. And lastly, 2 times 0.23. That gives us 0.46. Once we have all our values, we sum them and store the result in the destination neuron. We then do the same for every neuron of the next layer. Once we fill the second layer, we will do the same to fill the second hidden layer. And lastly, we will fill our output neurons. Here we can see that the values that we got are completely different from the value we were hoping for. But that's not a big surprise because when we initialize a neural network, we will always start by initializing the weights with totally random values. So that's not a big surprise that the neural network is not giving us the result we were hoping for. But this first forward pass with its mistake will give us a start point to try to increase the quality of the result that the neural network is giving us. So here we can see that in these square boxes, I've stored the difference between what we were expected and what we got. And with that value, we will not enter in the detail of the mass that are implied here, but we can have kind of an instinctive understanding of how the neural network is going to learn, because this value minus 0.05 does not come from nowhere. We know that it's coming from this neuron multiplied by this weight plus this neuron multiplied by this weight, etc., etc. So what we can do, I can say, okay, let's focus on this first weight of minus 0.42 here and ask myself the question, what if the weight was a little bit higher than what it was? Would it have given me a result that is closer to what I expect, or would it have given me a result that is further from what I expect? And what if the value was a little bit lower? We can ask ourselves this question for all of the weights that make the neural network. And then what we will do with the backwards propagation is that we will have that loop. We'll see, okay, this one, I would have gotten a better result if the weight was a little bit higher. Then I will make it just a very little bit higher, but very tiny bit. We're going very slowly there. And then we will repeat the operation for all the weights of the neural network, and we will go backwards to the very start of our neural networks. So this backward path basically took all the weights and tried to move them extremely slowly towards a direction that would give us a better result. Once we've done that, then we run forward our neural network again and see what we get. We can see here that the result is much better on this side. It's a little bit worse on that side, but globally, we've won with what we've done. And then we repeat the operation again and again. And each time we are moving our weights very, very slowly towards a better result. And if we do that, I think about 10 times, we can see here that we're getting closer. Yes, there we are. So after about 10 or 15 iterations, we got our neural network to do what we were asking him to do. So that's problematic is not really interesting. That was a very simple problem that we asked our neural network. But we can see that the concepts behind the learning process of the neural networks are extremely simple. And what we've done here for such a simple problem, we can do the same with a much bigger neural network with hundreds of thousands of neurons and weights that we will feed with 60,000 pictures of 28 by 28 pixels with our member. And somehow, by using this exact same method, we will have a neural network that will learn how to recognize numbers. So I think I'll do the same to go back to my slides, stop sharing and come back.
Can I ask a quick question there?
Yeah, of course.
Is it mathematically guaranteed that you won't get stuck and never actually achieve the number?
Yeah, there is a real possibility with that. What's happening, for example, neural networks work very, very well with the MNIST dataset, but you always have to be careful to what you give your neural network as a training set. As I told you, we train the MNIST dataset with 60,000 images, which is really good, and it will give us some results that positive around 98%, which is really amazing. But for example, if I was to use 60,000 images, but that 90% of them were any number, let's say 90% of them were the number six. When starting to train the neural network would find a very short shortcut to come to 90% of good answers. That would be just always give number six as a result. And when doing that, here we would go in a local minima, and we will not be able to get out of it because we gave the ability to the neural network to take a shortcut that was wrong, and we need to be very, very careful about the set of data that we are feeding our neural network
with. And if you get stuck in a local minima, do you then just exit from there, or do you try to make big jumps instead? Or
no, most of the time I think you will just stop there, try to understand, because it sometimes it's easy to understand why you had your neural network ended up in local minima. Sometimes it's much more complicated. So what you need to do is really try to understand, and that's where experience is important. Try to understand how is it that this result that we are not happy with, how is it that our neural network came to that? Why the neural network when learning found this path to this kind of thing? For example, when I'm working with frame prediction, so I'm giving five frames to the neural network and I want it to give me the sixth one, I could see that basically around every edges of the forms in the video that are moving, the neural network would just make everything blurry, like a mix of the colors of the shape on the right and the shape in the middle, and it would just give me something that's really blurry, not trying at all to give me a precise result and really moving the shape. So that one is much more complicated to identify than the one with the numbers. So basically, if you go to a local minima, you're not happy about what the neural network is doing, you should really try to investigate and understand why the neural network came to that point.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks for that question, Burkhard. And there's a comment here from Pranas I'll raise that he comments that momentum can help you get out of local minima, and atom optimization can help avoid landing there. So he mentions that as a couple of methods too.
Thank you for the information.
Yeah, thank you, Pranas.
Do we have any other question, or are we happy to continue?
We're ready to go on. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Let me share my screen again. Okay. So what we've just done is called supervised learning. So here we have a quick animation of the learning process, the backward and the forward and backward propagation, but applied to our MNIST problematic. That's exactly the same thing that what we've done. And we call this one supervised learning because we used labeled data set to do that. It was great that we had those 60,000 pictures of and written digits, but we were only able to train our neural network because with each single one of these images, we were also having the value, the number that is represented on that image. And that means that some human being have been labeling the data. Some people had to spend the time to have a look at each one of these images and just tell this one's a five, this one's a seven. And because we had this labeled data, we were able to train this neural network. And that the labeling of the training data is a problematic that we meet a lot when working with neural networks, and it's taking a lot of time, and it requires quite often a lot of people working on not very interesting tasks. And as well, even if that's not such a big problem, even training a neural network on the MNIST data already start to require quite a lot of computational power. Then I'd like to talk to you about another architecture of a neural network, because I find it really interesting and I kind of find it helps to understand what the neural network is doing. So this type of neural network is called the autoencoder. So in our example, we will be working with an autoencoder to which we will give our 28 by 28 representation of unwritten digits. But this time, we will ask the neural network to give us the exact same thing as an input. So that doesn't sound really interesting as a task, but there's a trick here because we will set up a bottleneck inside our neural network. In the example I've been working on, so we are having images of 784 pixels, and I gave the autoencoder a bottleneck of only 9 neurons. So that's nearly a compression of 100 times. And by going through this bottleneck, the neural network is supposed to be able to give us the exact same image that we gave it as an input. Here are a list of other examples. So we can see on the top line, the numbers that we're giving as an input to the autoencoder. In the middle is just a representation of the bottleneck, the 9 neurons that we are having in the middle. And on the bottom, we're having the resulting image that our autoencoder was able to give us. So if it's not perfect, it's already quite good with that level of compression that we are using there. And something that I find interesting here is when we have a look at these 5 numbers that we are giving it as an input, we can see that it's having a small imperfection in the top line. And this imperfection, we don't have it in the output. Our autoencoder didn't give it back. So clearly, here the autoencoder is making a mistake. We asked the autoencoder to give us the exact same image, and it failed doing that. But what really is interesting is that when doing a mistake, the autoencoder made a mistake that is quite intelligent. It didn't light up any random pixel in the image. Sorry. But the pixels that were wrongly lighted are actually making sense. And what we see here is that by giving this constraint to our neural network, we kind of forced it to detect patterns in the data that we are giving it. And our neural network kind of learned that it was evolving in a universe of lines. And lastly, so in order to loop, to close the loop with the first part on computer vision and the convolution, I will quickly talk about the convolutional neural networks. So convolutional neural networks are another architecture of neural networks. They are very efficient when working with images. And what convolutional neural networks are doing is that they are applying the convolution algorithm that we've seen at the beginning with the computer vision. So instead of having this huge list of neurons that are all connected to one another, as we've seen in the linear model, the convolutional neural network will actually create some kernels that it will use to run convolution of the image that we are giving it. And the values in the kernels are actually the weight of the neural network. And that's by filling these values in the kernels of the convolution that are used for convolution that the neural network will learn. Why is it working so well with images? Because it retains the pixel positioning information. We could see in our first example with the linear network that we were taking all the 784 pixels from the image and just building a single vector of values. And by doing that, we were losing the information about what pixel is positioned next to what other pixel. And when we're dealing with convolutional neural network, we are not transforming the image anymore. We will keep on working on our 2D image, and the convolutional kernels will be run on that 2D image, taking into account the localization information. Here is something that I find really interesting. So we can see this is kind of a representation of the kernels that are being created automatically by a convolutional neural network when trying to learn to detect faces. And we can see that the first layers of the convolutional neural network will actually learn to detect very simple shapes like lines, circles, angles. And the deeper we will go into our network, the more the network will be able to associate single shapes together, resulting in more complex shapes, like some of them are looking like eyes, noses, mouths. And then when we go at the very end of our neural network, we will see that we are now able to identify very complex shapes like faces. So convolutional neural networks are quite interesting as well, because we can a little bit easier have a look at what the neural network is actually doing.